All right, let's get into our topic for this evening. I'm just going to take a drink of water because we are starting a bit late, so I'm going to try and get through as much as I can. Now, I know this topic is really interesting for you guys. I know it's not a pleasant topic, the topic of homosexuality. I think it's a very relevant topic, though, for, you know, sort of the day and age that we live in. So what I'm going to go through today are just the two examples in the Bible of societies that did fall to this rampant fornication and homosexuality, and go through those stories together and some things that we can learn from them. So these are examples of homosexuality in the Bible. The first one I'm going to go to, which I don't personally think is an example. I've heard other people say that it's an example. I don't think it's clear enough to really know that it is an example of homosexuality. But let's go there in Genesis 9, verse 18, which is the story of Noah and his son Ham. And it says here, "And the sons of Noah that went forth of the ark were Shem and Ham and Japheth, and Ham is the father of Canaan. These are the three sons of Noah, and of them was the whole earth overspread. And Noah began to be an husbandman, and he planted a vineyard, and he drank of the wine, and was drunken, and was uncovered within his tent." So isn't it interesting that Noah is like this great preacher of righteousness, and, you know, in the New Testament he is glorified as a godly man, but he didn't end very well, did he? I mean, he got off the ark, he did this great thing, he built this ark, he saved these people, saved all these animals, as God had commanded him, and then he gets off the ark, and then he builds a vineyard, and he makes wine, and then he gets drunk, you know. So, but it just goes to show that, you know, you can end bad and yet still be saved. You know, like people think, oh, you know, you're going to endure to the end. You're going to be, you know, once you get saved, there's going to be this change, and you're just going to go up and up and up and up all the way until, you know, you die and go to glory in heaven. But that's not always the example we see. I mean, we see Saul committing suicide. We see Noah here getting off the ark and getting drunk. And that's the last thing we hear about him. He gets drunk, he curses Canaan, and that's the end of Noah's story. So not a very good way to end, but of course he was saved. He was used greatly of God. But didn't necessarily endure to the end. It says here, "And he drank of the wine and was drunken, and he was uncovered within his tent. And Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father and told his two brethren without. And Shem and Japheth took a garment and laid it upon both their shoulders and went backward and covered the nakedness of their father, and their faces were backward, and they saw not their father's nakedness. And Noah woke from his wine and knew what his younger son had done unto him. And he said, Cursed be Canaan, a servant of servants shall he be unto his brethren. And he said, Blessed be the Lord God of Shem, and Canaan shall be his servant." So if you missed what happened here, so they get up, they're off the ark now. Noah builds a vineyard, and he makes wine, and he gets drunk, and he's drunk in his tent and uncovered, right? It makes me think, you know, we were talking about when we talked about clothing and men wearing those robes, and remember we talked about them going up the steps and uncovering their nakedness. I mean, if they were wearing pants in these days, how would his nakedness be uncovered? Have you thought about that? So if they were all wearing pants, and that's just what they wore day in and day out, and maybe they wore a robe over their pants, if he's drunk in his tent and he's fallen over or something, why would his nakedness be uncovered? But if they're wearing the robe, and like when they walk up the stairs, their nakedness would be uncovered. That's why they had to have the linen breeches. That makes sense that they might be wearing that sort of garment. So he's uncovered in his tent, and then Ham comes in and sees him naked. But rather than just covering him up, goes and tells his other two brothers, and his other two brothers come in, don't want to look at their dad naked. They're actually walking backwards with their faces backward with a cloth and cover their father's nakedness. And when he wakes up, he realizes what happens. Now, some people have taken this to think that Ham maybe did something to his dad, like maybe he molested him or raped him or something like that. So when Noah awakes from his wine, it says here in verse 24, and knew what his younger son had done unto him, they take that to mean that he did something sexual to him, maybe molested him or something like that. I guess I'm not willing to say that this is an event of homosexuality, because I don't think it's clear enough to know exactly what it is that he knew he did to him. Did he know what he had done unto him because it was something physical? Or did he know what he had done unto him because he heard about it later? Or, you know, maybe the fact that he saw his father naked, and rather than just covering him up straight away, he went and told others And then they went and realized the shame of it and covered their father up. And that's what he was upset at. So I don't know whether it's clear enough to be dogmatic that this is an instance of a homosexual act. So I don't know whether I would take that as an example. So I just went to that one quickly. Let's go to the one I'm going to spend the most time on, which is in Genesis 19. And this is the story of Sodom and Gomorrah. And really, in the Bible, this is really the example of what God thinks about homosexuality in a society. So let's read through this, and we'll cross-reference some other passages as we go through this. So let's read it first, Genesis 19, and we'll read down to verse 26. And there came two angels to Sodom at even, and Lot sat in the gate of Sodom, and Lot, seeing them, rose up to meet them, and he bowed himself with his face toward the ground. And he said, "Behold now, my lords, turn in, I pray you, into your servant's house, and tarry all night, and wash your feet. He shall rise up early and go on your ways." And they said, "Nay, but we will abide in the street all night." And he pressed upon them greatly, and they turned in unto him and entered into his house, and he made them a feast, and did bake unleavened bread, and did eat. All right, let's just stop there for now. So a couple of things is, for you, most of you will be pretty familiar with the story, but we see here that the angels come to Sodom and Gomorrah because they're trying to see how wicked this place is. They've heard the cries, because generally when a society is taken over with fornication and homosexuality and adultery, there's a lot of a baby killing going on. You know, we like to call it terminating a pregnancy or abortion, but it's murdering of babies, and a lot of that blood is crying out to the Lord from the ground to seek justice. So God is hearing this evil in this city, and these cries, the evil of it is really great, and he sent these angels to actually go and see for themselves whether it be so. You know, sort of this mouth in the mouth of two or three witnesses shall every word be established. So these angels almost are like going down to witness the evil so that they can testify of it and God can carry out this judgment. Wonder if there's a bit of symbolism here. So they come to this city, and Lot is sitting in the gate, and he sees these two angels. He invites them to his house, and they say, no, we're not going to go to your house. We're just going to basically sleep in the street tonight. And obviously, Lot knows that's a bad idea. So he's like, no. He's like pressing on them. No, stay with me. It's too dangerous to be out in the street. Now think about this for a second. If Lot knew that Sodom was such a wicked, evil, and dangerous place, why was he still living there? You know, why was Lot still living there when he realized how bad it was? And even when we go to 2 Peter, let's just go there, 2. And we read about how God actually made Sodom and Gomorrah an example in the New Testament of judgment on a people. For if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell, and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved unto judgment, and spared not the old world, but saved Noah, the eighth person, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood upon the world of the ungodly, and turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemn them with an overthrow, making them an ensample unto those that after should live ungodly. So it's interesting here in the New Testament, God is saying Sodom and Gomorrah is an example to us. So if we go back and see what happened with Sodom and Gomorrah, we can get an idea of what God thinks about homosexuality, fornication, and societies that allow it to go rampant. It says here, and delivered just Lot, vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked. For that righteous man dwelling among them, in seeing and hearing, vexed his righteous soul from day to day with their unlawful deeds. So you see here that, you know, Lot, we know that he was saved because it says here he was just Lot, and this is why he was taken out of Sodom and Gomorrah. Because in verse 9 it says here, the Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. But look at what it says here in verse 8. For that righteous man dwelling among them, in seeing and hearing, vexed his righteous soul from day to day. What does that mean, that your soul is vexed? It means you're troubled. You know, you're in this place and it's constantly bugging you. Do you know what I mean? Have you ever been in that situation where you're in a situation that you don't want to be in and it just bugs you to no end? So if this is the case with Lot in Sodom and Gomorrah, let's just go back there in Genesis 19. Why was he still there? Well, look at verse 1. And there came two angels to Sodom at evening, even, and Lot sat in the gate of Sodom. Now, if you're familiar with the Bible, when you sit in the gate, it's because you're a respected elder in that city. And you just kind of wonder, I mean, obviously, I'm just thinking out loud about what the situation might have been. You know, maybe Lot had a position of authority in that city. You know, maybe he had a cushy job there. Maybe he had investments there. Maybe he had started a business in Sodom and Gomorrah. And for him to leave Sodom and Gomorrah would mean he had to rebuild his business again. Or maybe, you know, he had owned property in Sodom and Gomorrah. He had to look after it, manage that property, and it was too troublesome for him to leave and move. And what that makes me think of is just where people decide to live these days. You know, if we're applying it to our own lives, sometimes people make decisions in their own lives not based on spiritual priorities, but financial priorities. Right? Think about where you live, where you decide to move, the house you bought, all that sort of thing. And I'm not saying they're not important, but you need to be careful that these things are not more important than keeping God's commandments. And unfortunately, a lot of people end up making financial decisions and prioritize those rather than their spiritual decisions. And the classic example is always, you know, you move to get that job, you know, that promotion that you've been offered, and maybe you have to move country, or you have to travel a lot, or you have to move states, but you don't even know whether there's a good church within that area where you're moving. And people will move not having a church to attend, not having a congregation to be a part of, and they're making a really bad decision because they leave, they don't have the fellowship, and they end up growing cold, and that sort of thing. So you wonder, hey, maybe that was the situation of Lot. Maybe it's because Lot obviously did not want to be there. His soul was vexed, right, day and night, seeing these unlawful deeds, but he didn't just, you know, take one step back in order to take two steps forward. He stayed there and, you know, eventually stayed there until the end, where God actually had to even pull him out before destroying the city. So, you know, you might need to leave sometimes a job to take a lower paying job for a temporary time. Sometimes you need to take that step back in order to take two steps forward for the Lord if you're in a job that is not pleasing to the Lord. Or you may have to rebuild your business. You know, maybe you're in a situation, you're trying to get out of it. Sometimes you have to take one step back to take two steps forward. You know, maybe sometimes you need to loosen some connections with people that you're familiar with. You know, maybe it's friends or family, to move somewhere where you can be part of a church, you can be part of a soul-winning group, so that you don't backslide, you don't get into that situation. Because sometimes people are not willing to give up those things, they're not willing to give up those connections. But if you think about it, sometimes those relationships and those connections are not helping you. They're not pushing you in the right direction. And you know how it is sometimes. You know people that you like to hang out with, and they're the people you gravitate towards, but are they people that are pushing you towards the Lord? Are they people that are, every time you're with them, they're spurring you on to do more soul winning? You talk about the Bible together, or do you find that you just gravitate towards them and they just pull you down, they discourage you, they get you back in your old ways again, in your worldly behaviors, and it's not good for you. And the more you live in sin, the harder it is to do what's right. You know, because us looking at Lot, and we're just thinking, like, what the hell are you doing? Like, get out of there. It's a wicked place. But, you know, in our life, it's the same. You know, Lot probably just didn't realize, because when you're living amongst the stench, and you're living amongst the filth, you get used to it. It becomes acceptable to you. It becomes the norm. But it's not until you take a step back and look at it from God's view that you realize, man, I really need to make a change in my life and make some changes, because this is really stopping me from serving God to the full extent that I could be. And you know, the things of God, they ought to be important enough to you to be consistent in your service to God. And really, you want to get to the point in your spiritual life where, you know, when it comes to church, when it comes to soul winning, people are shocked that you're not there. Because a lot of you, people are shocked when you come. You know, it's like when you come, it's like, oh man, I didn't expect you to be here. Or I didn't expect you to come soul winning today, because you're never there. But, you know, that should be the other way around. It should be that, you know, when you come and then when you don't come, people are like, oh man, did you get hit by a bus or something? Because I know that's how important the things of God are to him, that he's going to be there, hell or high water. It doesn't matter what's going to happen. I know that I'm going to see that person there if he said he's going to be there. that's where you want to get to in your spiritual life. You know, isn't the things of God important enough to you to prioritize it to that extent? And you know, when we think about our service to God, you know, some people, you know, they want to grow, so they get in church, they want to get under the preaching and things like that. But you know, when it, if you really think about what makes you grow as a Christian, it's not really the preaching that really makes you grow. It's not even really the fellowship that makes you grow. Because how many people do we know, they probably listen to more preaching than I do online. You know, like they just listen to sermon after sermon after sermon after sermon, but they're not really growing. Or they might be, what about people that come to church week after week after week, but they find they're not growing in their spiritual life? Because that's not really what makes you grow in the spiritual life. What makes you grow is doing the work. You know, when you're actually serving together, and just generally people that are at church all the time, they get involved, and that's what's actually making them grow. It's not just the hearing the preaching every week. So you don't want to kid yourself that you come every week and just hear the preaching and just participate, and, you know, just come along for church and you're going to grow. You grow by actually doing the work. It's no different to, you know, building your muscles. If you want to get stronger physically, you can't just keep eating and eating and eating and eating, or you can't just like be hanging out at the gym, right? Like I say, you eat a lot and then you go to the gym and then you're just like hanging out there and just like in the presence of the machinery. You know, that's not actually going to get you big muscles. What's going to get you big muscles is you got to actually work out on those machines. And it's the same in the spiritual life. If you want to get strong spiritually, you need to put that knowledge into practice. You need to be a doer of the work. And then you'll actually start growing as a Christian and seeing some results in your life. Let's just go to James quickly. James 1, look at what it says here. It's a really familiar passage, but one that's always so relevant and just like at multiple times in your life, throughout your life. Because, you know, we all go up. And we all go down, we all go up and we all go down. And sometimes we need to be reminded when we get to a point where we are only hearing the word, but not doing the word, we need to be reminded how vain that really is. But it says here in James 1, verse 22, "But be ye doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves." So why does the Bible say that we're deceived? Because you feel like you're participating a lot. You feel like you're really involved. You know, because, you know, maybe you come to church. I mean, our church only meets once a week. But let's say you're at a church that meets three times a week and you just feel really involved in the activity because, you know, you're at the gym all the time, but you're not actually doing anything at the gym. So you just feel like you're always doing something. But the Bible says here, if you just hear the word, but you're not a doer of the word, you're tricking yourself. You've deceived yourself into thinking that you're actually doing something for the Lord when you're not. If you just hear this preaching, you know, you hear me talk about soul winning all the time. You hear me talk about, hey, be consistent at church. You hear me talking about, hey, prioritize the Lord. But you don't actually do it, what's going to happen? "For if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass." It's like you're looking at yourself in the mirror. "For he beholdeth himself and goeth his way and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was." So he's saying here, if you hear the word and you don't do anything, you're like somebody that's looking at yourself in the mirror. You see a problem, you know, but then you just forget about it straight away and just leave that mirror. It's like you look at yourself in the mirror and your hair's all messed up and you're like, ugh. But then you don't do anything about it. That's what it's like when you hear the word preached and then you don't do anything about it. You're as foolish as somebody who sees a problem, but then just forgets about it straight away. "But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein." See, so you're not only hearing the word, but you're doing it. "He being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work." So you see that contrast there. Why will you not forget what you've heard? Because you're actually going to do it. If you do it, then you won't be a forgetful hearer. "This man shall be blessed in his deed." So this is the point we want to get to when we are, you know, trying to do something for the Lord. You want to get to that point and have things, have the things of God important to you. Let me show you this verse in John 15. says here in verse 2, this principle of, you know, we're a branch in Jesus and we want to bear fruit. Says here in verse 2, every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. So you see here, a branch that's not bearing any fruit, God says he takes it away. What that means can mean several things. But you see here, it's a branch that is trying to bear fruit that God starts working on. So if you want to grow as a Christian, you need to start trying to bear fruit. You don't just sit back and say, oh, God's going to start bearing fruit in my life. When I start bearing fruit, I'm going to start trying to bear more fruit. No, it's a branch that is already bearing fruit. God then purges it. He cleans it up so that it'll bring forth more fruit. And any of you that are familiar with, you know, growing plants and things like that, sometimes you need to clean up the excess leaves on these plants in order for them to bring forth more fruit. Why? Because these leaves take resources from what could be going to the fruit. So I remember when I was trying my best to like grow some tomatoes, right? But I think I actually purged the branches too much because I was thinking, okay, I purged the branches so that my tomatoes will be bigger, but then I just purged them all and then they died anyway because there's no leaves to like get the sun. So, but that's a good lesson because you see, if there's too many leaves on a plant, it's kind of like the excess things in our life, right? The cares of this life and the things that we do for pleasure. You know, we're soaking in that sun. When there's too much, it starts to draw away from bearing fruit for the Lord. But think about it. If we had no leaves at all as a branch, we also can't bring forth fruit. Why? Because you'll burn out. Because you don't have any leisure time at all. So you see that there's a balance with having some leisure time so that you can refresh, so that you can have a clear mind, you can get enough sleep and things like that. You need some of those leaves on your branch just so you can bring forth that fruit. But you can't get rid of all the leaves. At the same time, you can't have too much leaves. If you have too much leaves, you won't bring forth as much fruit as you can. But the point here being, if you want to bring forth more fruit for God, you've got to start trying to bear fruit. God's going to see that fruit that you're trying to bear, and he's going to help you clean up your life and make changes so that you'll bring forth more fruit. All right, let's go. At this rate, I'll probably never get through Genesis 19. There's some really cool lessons in this passage here, Genesis 19. We'll get there eventually. So, why was Lot still there? Well, you know, maybe because he had some important things there in his life. We know we're not saying that these things are not important. You know, obviously your job is important, family is important, you know, your business is important, but they're not more important than God. And you don't want to put yourself in a compromising position because you've prioritized financial things rather than spiritual things. So he gets these angels to stay in his house and he bakes them unleavened bread. Let's read from verse 4. But before they lay down, the men of the city, even the men of Sodom, compassed the house round, both old and young, all the people from every quarter. And they called unto Lot and said unto him, where are the men which came into thee this night? Bring them out unto us, that we may know them. And Lot went out at the door unto them and shut the door after him and said, I pray you, brethren, do not so wickedly. Behold, now I have two daughters which have not known man. Let me, I pray you, bring them out unto you, and do ye to them as is good in your eyes. Only unto these men do nothing, for therefore came they under the shadow of my roof. you can see what happens here in a society that becomes just so wicked. This is really, God is giving us an example of the bottom of the barrel. Where these people are coming, they see these angels. I don't know if they know that they were angels, but what sort of people comes along randomly and just wants to gang rape these two guys that are just visiting their city? This is what God is warning us of. And this is, you know, when we think about this, this is why God instituted the death penalty for these types of sins, for homosexuality, because he's giving us two examples in the Bible here, what happens to a society when it is allowed to promulgate and just run rampant within a society. So we can see what happens when fornication takes over society. Now, when we think about this, in verse 8, if you realize what's happening here. So they're knocking on the door. They want to basically rape these two angels that have come to visit Sodom and Gomorrah. They compass the house roundabout. They say, hey, bring them out here because we want to know them, the Bible says there. And that's not just like, you know, sit down and have a chat and discuss doctrine with them. They want to actually bring them out and rape them. Lot goes out to the door. Now, first of all, in verse 7, he says here, and I pray you, brethren, do not so wickedly. Now, look at this. See, Lot has been living in Sodom and Gomorrah for so long that these people come to his door. They want to break it down. They want to rape two of his guests. And he's still like, hey, bro, like, what's the deal? What are you guys doing? What sort of attitude is that? Maybe because he's been living with them for so long. It's in his face all day. And he doesn't realize the seriousness of what these people are doing. And look at this. He says, behold now, I have two daughters which have not known man. Let me, I pray you, bring them out unto you, and do ye to them as is good in your eyes, only unto these men do nothing. For therefore came they under the shadow of my roof. Now I wonder whether this story here, you know, does it sort of illustrate that when we as Christians don't take a stand for the word of God, it's almost like we're giving our family over to the enemy. You know, like we don't take a stand. And yes, here, I mean, what sort of father even does this? You know, somebody that's maybe just been so warped in this society that he thinks that this is an all right thing to do, rather than, you know, instead of giving them an alternative person to rape, you know, taking a stand. But when Christians don't take a stand, it's almost like figuratively here, you know, we're just willing to give our family and our children and our standards over to the world if we don't stand up for something we believe in. Yeah, because what sort of person gives his two virgin daughters to a bunch of homosexual gang rapists? But see, living amongst the filth will affect your own standard of righteousness. And it's the same in our life, right? When you're around friends or family that don't have your same standards, don't have your same stances, you find it starts to rub off on you, doesn't it? You start to dress like them. You know, especially kids that go to public school and they're around kids of parents that are not saved, that watch a lot of movies, that have all the Hollywood stars as their idols, and they want to copy their hairstyles and copy their dress and copy the way they dress. You're going to start dressing like this. And how many times have we seen it in churches where we see the young people growing up and they're mainly hanging around with their parents and they dress like their parents and they look like somebody respectable, and then they go to school and it's like, what happened to this person? You know, this weird haircut, start wearing skinny pink and purple jeans, they start caring about their shoes and what product they put in their hair and all this sort of stuff. What happened to them? It's because they're hanging around these people too much. And it starts to rub off on you. So your dress will start to be like these people. You know, you hang around with your old friends, you start to dress like them again. You'll start to want to look like them again. You'll want to, you know, talk like them again. It'll bring up the old interests that really you should cut out of your life. It'll bring those up again. And your conversation will be like theirs too, because you'll be talking with them. That's going to be rubbing off on you. Because it's so much easier for people to pull you down than it is for you to get up and do something great for the Lord. And this is why church is so important. And this is why you have to get involved in church, serve in church, because you want to make some friends at this church. So these are the people you hang around, and we can provoke each other unto love and good works, rather than, you know, you hanging out with your old high school mates because you don't want to make friends with people at church. And I get it. The flesh is proud. The flesh is lazy. The flesh is comfortable with your old friends. And it takes work to make friends, doesn't it? That's why, you know, it's so easy to make friends at school, because you're with them all the time and you don't have all these different opinions and standards. You're just all having fun. But then it's so easy to stay friends with those people that you don't take the effort to actually love your brothers and sisters in Christ and make friends with them, get to know them, so that you can provoke each other unto love and good works. It's not an easy thing to do. And this is why it's so, one of the difficulties of any church is just getting everyone to integrate, you know, getting everyone out of their own cliques, you know, and reaching beyond that. And there's no magical way to do that. You just got to start with you. You know, it's got to start with you. You know, you want to go, you want this church to be friendlier? Hey, you got to be friendlier. You want this church to be warm? You have to be warm. You want this church to love and pray for one another? It's got to start with you. And as everyone does it, it becomes a church that is loving. You know, it's not just this magical switch that a church is loving or not. It's because the people within that church are loving. The people within that church care about each other. But if you're the sort of church member that comes, you don't care about anybody. You don't care what anyone's life is. You're just here to see what you can get out of this church. You come here, oh, that sermon was boring. You just come for the sermon, you go. You don't care like how anybody else is going. That's what this church is going to be like, right? Because that's what the church is comprised of. It's comprised of the people here. So, you know, it's just like that old adage that you always hear. You know, you got to be the change you want to see in the world. You want to be the change you want to see in this church. But what else do we learn here out of these verses? We see here just the vileness of homosexuality. Because even though Lot is doing this wicked thing by offering his two virgin daughters to these homosexual gang rapists that have come to his door, but to him, that's less of a crime, that's less vile in his eyes than the men outside having sex with the men inside his house. Do you see here? So even in this warped society back in Genesis 19, we see here the vileness and the disgustingness of homosexuality, that somebody is willing to give his virgin daughters over rather than allowing homosexuality to happen. So it's gang rape in Lot's eyes to his two daughters was more acceptable than gang rape to two men in this instance. All right, let's go on. Verse 9 says here, and they said, stand back. And they said again, this one fellow came in to sojourn. So he's saying here that Lot came to Sodom and Gomorrah just to live for a temporary time, not permanently. That's what it means to sojourn. And he will needs be a judge. Now will we deal worse with thee than with them? And they pressed sore upon the man, even Lot, and came near to break the door. Now when I read this verse, it just, what I think of when I read verse 9, it just goes to show that the homosexual agenda and those that hate God, they're still using the judge not mantra back then. You know, I'd say, you know, I'm sure when they're knocking on the door and you know, Lot saying to the crowd, brethren, don't do so wickedly. I'm sure you can hear somebody at the back of the crowd going, doesn't the Bible say don't judge? I'm sure it's no different back then. You know, it's the same today. They're saying don't judge. We need to tolerate everyone. You know, anti-discrimination. Nothing has changed, folks. It's all the same. Even back then, they're saying, are you judging us? Are you telling us what we're doing is wrong? Yes. We're saying that homosexuality is wrong. It's a sin. It's punishable by death if we had a perfect government. That's what we're telling them. Yeah, it's not wrong to judge. We have to judge righteous judgment, the Bible says. So, yes, we judge. We don't have a problem with that. And anyone who says judge not is a hypocrite. Because in order to say don't judge, you're making a judgment. This is why, you know, in companies, I'm not going to name the company, but in companies that I'm very familiar with, it's really annoying when they try and promote equality. Have you seen that in the world? They want to promote gender equality and all this stuff. So how do they do it? They only have programs for one gender. Is that not hypocritical? You know, you want to promote equality amongst women, equal pay, equal position, equal opportunity, what they call equal opportunity employer. So what do? You only have special opportunities for women. You only have special, you know, programs for women, special conventions for women. How's that promoting equality? I thought equality is like both genders get it, but it's equality when only one gender gets it. I don't see how people don't see the hypocrisy of just this equal of everybody, and yet it only be doing it for one gender. You know, most people would be so upset if they had a program just for Christians, or they had a program just for men. You know, if you held a program and you only allowed men, people would have all their knickers in a knot, right? Because of that. But if you do something for women these days, that's equality. That's pushing gender equal opportunity amongst genders. And it's just hypocritical. Same with the judge not mentality, or even the, you know, I tolerate all views mentality, because they don't tolerate the view that doesn't tolerate all views. You know, so it's all hypocrisy and nothing has changed. Let's go to, let's keep going. Verse 10, but the men put forth their hand and pulled Lot into the house, to them and shut to the door. So the angels now like grab Lot, pull him in, and they smote the men that were at the door of the house with blindness, both small and great, so that they wearied themselves to find the door. Now, every time I read verse 11, it just blows my mind because of the depravity of these people. I mean, think about it. If let's say you're part of an angry mob, right? And you're going to this door and you want to, like, you know, cause some trouble. And then all of a sudden, you're struck with blindness. What would be your reaction? You'd be like, ah, like, I can't see. What's happening? But what happens with these guys? They're blinded at the door, and what happened? They wearied themselves to find the door. So even though they're struck blind by these angels, they're still trying to get in and get to these angels. It like just makes you chill when you think about this situation here and just how depraved these people were. And the men said unto Lot, hast thou here any besides son-in-law and thy sons and thy daughters and whatsoever thou hast in the city? Bring them out of this place, for we will destroy this place, because the cry of them is waxing great before the face of the Lord, and the Lord hath sent us to destroy it. Now, where did I get up to? Okay. So we see here, this is the example, like we read in 2 Peter 2, of what God thinks about a society that's overrun with homosexuality. He rains fire and brimstone on it later. But let's go on, verse 14. And Lot went out and spake unto his sons-in-law, which married his daughters, and said, up, get you out of this place, for the Lord will destroy the city. But he seemed as one that mocked unto his sons-in-law. And this is the same in our life. You see how when Lot actually tried to go and warn his sons-in-law. So obviously it looks like here he's got more than two daughters. He's got two daughters that are living with him that are virgins, and then he's got other daughters that have married other men, and he has sons-in-law. So these angels have come and pronounced this judgment on this city. Lot then goes to warn them, to say, hey, God's going to destroy this city, let's get out of here. And what do they think about him? They say, but he seemed as one that mocked unto his sons-in-law. They didn't take him seriously. And you know, if you don't take your spiritual life seriously, your family's not going to take your spiritual life seriously either. Like, if you don't prioritize the things of God, if you don't take Christianity seriously, why would anybody else around you take it seriously? So it's the same when we prioritize things. You know, I find in my own life, because I've tried to always prioritize the things of God, I find my family also prioritizes it, in the sense that, you know, not only just my immediate family, but I mean my family when they create events. You know, if they know I go to church on Sunday night and they want me to be at that birthday party or that family event, they don't do it on Sunday night. Because they know if they do it on Sunday night, I'm not going to be there. And what I found in my family is if they know that, and if you miss enough events showing them, hey, no, church is more important to me than this family event, they'll have it on a Saturday night. Because if they want you to be there, they'll do it on a Saturday night in order for everyone to be there. So why don't we make others cater for what is truly important rather than us always compromising? We're always skipping church. We're always putting God second for our family, as opposed to setting the example that, hey, we want God first, and we want our family to see that God is first, that we are even willing to miss things in order to make it to church or make it for an event. For we will destroy... Oh, here we go. But he seemed as one that mocked. And when the morning arose, then the angels hastened Lot, saying, arise, take thy wife and thy two daughters, which are here, lest thou be consumed in the iniquity of the city. And while he lingered, the men laid hold upon his hand and upon the hand of his wife and upon the hand of his two daughters, the Lord being merciful unto him. And they brought him forth and set him without the city. Now, this is really interesting if you didn't know this about the story of Lot in Sodom and Gomorrah. Because you know when you watch those Bible movies, right, that they're so accurate and they just follow the Bible word for word and everything like that. Every Sodom and Gomorrah sort of video I've seen, it's sort of, you know, the angels come and they're warning Lot, and it's like a quick rush to get out because God's about to rain fire and brimstone on it. And have you seen those movies where, you know, he's rushing out, they're just grabbing what they can, and it's like quick, quick, and there's just like chaos in the street, and then they just get out of the city, and then it's like boom, God drops the bonfire on them and destroys the city. But this is not actually what happened. If you see here, it says here, and while he lingered, the men laid hold upon his hand and upon the hand of his wife and upon the hand of his two daughters, the Lord being merciful unto him. And they brought him forth and set him without the city. So it's not even that Lot is trying to get everything together and get out of the city. He's like lingering and hanging around. And I don't know what he's thinking here, you know, because God's about to destroy the city. But it's actually the angels that have to literally drag him out of the city and take him out of the city. Otherwise, he would have stayed there. And what's interesting here is in this statement, it says here in verse 16, so he took upon the hand of his wife, upon the hand of his two daughters, the Lord being merciful unto him. And they brought him forth and set him without the city. So you see here, even in our most backslidden state, God still loves us. He still shows mercy to us. I mean, look, he's about to destroy this city. He's given Lot so many chances. Even after warning Lot that this city is about to be destroyed, he still literally, like, you know, by the angel's hand, literally drags Lot out of the city so that Lot is not consumed when he destroys Sodom and Gomorrah. This is the sort of love God has to the believers. You know, when you're not a believer, hey, there's no mercy there. There's no grace there. There's just judgment because you are a criminal in the eyes of God. But if you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, if you are saved, child of God, this is the love he has for you. This is the long suffering he has for you, that even when you are backslidden to the worst possible point, he is still taking care of you. He's still loving. He's still merciful towards you. And, you know, people have this idea that, you know, the God of the Old Testament is just all judgment and wrath and anger. Yeah, to the unbeliever. But to the believer, here's an example where even when Lot is not doing what he's commanded to do, he still wants to be in the place where he shouldn't be. God literally pulls him out of there himself. What an amazing God we have. All right, let's go on. And it came to pass when they had brought them forth abroad that he said, escape for thy life. Look not behind thee, neither stay thou in all the plain. Escape to the mountain, lest thou be consumed. And Lot said unto him, oh, not so, my Lord. Behold, now thy servant hath found grace in thy sight, and thou hast magnified thy mercy, which thou hast showed unto me in saving my life. And I cannot escape to the mountain, lest some evil take me, and I die. Behold, now, this city is near to flee unto, and it is a little one. Oh, let me escape thither. Is it not a little one, and my soul shall live? And he said unto him, see, I have accepted thee concerning this thing also, that I will not overthrow this city, for the which thou hast spoken. Hastily escape thither, for I cannot do anything till thou be come thither. Therefore the name of the city was called Zoar. The sun was risen upon the earth when Lot entered into Zoar. Then the Lord rained upon Sodom and upon Gomorrah, brimstone and fire from the Lord out of heaven. Now, I don't know if you realize this as well. So remember, Lot was not just fleeing the city. He had to be dragged out of the city. Even when he was dragged out of the city, the angels go, run, like get away as far as you can. And what does Lot do? He's like, ah, the mountains are too far away. You know, like, can I escape to this town? You know, it's just a little town. He's basically saying, like, you know, it's not that many people there. I know they're wicked, but just spare them just so I can flee there rather than fleeing all the way into the mountains. And there's a couple of things here. It's you know, we see the long-suffering God. We already talked about the long-suffering of God. I mean, even more so now, like, Lot is pushing. And God is saying here, like, I cannot do anything until I get you out. And that shows eternal security, right? We're always saved. God physically could not destroy that city because Lot was saved and he needed to get Lot out and deliver the godly out of temptation, like we saw in 2 Peter 2. But one thing I wonder here as well, and I don't know whether I'm sort of misapplying this, but one thought I had in this is even in our most backslidden state, God can still use us to get people saved. You know, it's almost like, you know, Lot didn't do anything right. He lingered in Sodom and Gomorrah. After he got out of Sodom and Gomorrah, he still didn't obey the Lord. He's being lazy. He's almost like justifying it like we do, like, oh man, I'm saved. I know I have eternal life. So I know God, you know, I can do this sin because I'm still going to be saved anyway, right? It's almost like this is what Lot is saying here. He's like, man, you show me your great mercy and everything like that, but can I just go to this city and not do what's right? So it's almost like here, you know, yes, Lot is representing a saved person, but here he's a backslidden saved person. And even in his backslidden state, it's almost like he's used to save this little city. So what I want to encourage you here, because sometimes people have this mentality, like, I don't want to get involved in the soul winning until I clean my life up. You know, I got some things, I got some ducks to get in a row. I've got things I need to take care of. Oh man, I've still got this sin in my life that I need to deal with that before I serve the Lord, because, you know, God's not going to want me to work for him. Rubbish. You know, God wants you to go and bring forth fruit, remember? And he's going to purge that branch so that you'll bring forth more fruit. So don't get this frame of mind that you can't be used by God, even though you're backslidden. You know, you never prioritize the things of God. You never think about the things of God. Just hold on to that rope. Don't fall off the bandwagon. You can still be used by God. You know, even if you don't feel like talking at the door, say, at soul winning, if you're just there as a silent partner, nobody knows how backslidden you are. Maybe, I mean, God obviously knows maybe how backslidden you are, and the sins that you're struggling with, or even the sins that you're not struggling with, you're just indulging in. But if you go, God can still use you. He can use that obedience by his grace. And hopefully, as you continue to walk with the Lord, he will purge these sins out of your life, and he will help change you. Because what? You're going to be walking in the Spirit. And as you walk in the Spirit, your spirit is going to get more hungry for the things of God. It's going to diminish the appetite of the flesh. And as that happens, you will get more, you'll see more and more change in your life. See, and he says here, the sun was risen upon the earth when Lot entered into Zoar. Then the Lord rained fire upon Sodom and upon Gomorrah, brimstone and fire from the Lord out of heaven. And he overthrew those cities and all the plain and all the inhabitants of the cities and that which grew upon the ground. But his wife looked back from behind him, and she became a pillar of salt. So this is a very famous example in the Bible where, you know, you got that verse, remember Lot's wife. One thing I think of here when I think of Lot's wife looking back and being consumed in the iniquity of the city is that salvation has to be a personal decision. You know, like Lot was delivered out of Sodom and Gomorrah, but that wasn't enough to save his wife. See, because his wife has to have salvation by Jesus Christ. So some of us, you know, have grown up in Christian families. You know, especially the kids here, you know, you're not going to get to heaven by the faith of your parents. Just like you're not going to get to heaven by the faith of your grandparents. You're not going to, you know, spouses are not going to get to heaven by the faith of their spouse. You need to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ yourself. Don't think, oh yeah, you know, my husband, he's really zealous. He's really into things. Yeah, he's going to get me into it. We're going to be fine. Or the other way around. Yeah, my wife has got things covered. She knows what we're doing. She knows what church we're going to. And, you know, I don't believe it, but, you know, we'll be fine because my wife is saved. No, you need to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ yourself. The faith of your spouse is not going to save you, or the faith of your parents are not going to save you. And likewise, the faith of your children. Because same, sometimes older generations, grandparents or parents, they just start going to a church because they want to spend more time with their kids. They go there and they're just there, but they're not actually saved. They don't actually believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. You are not going to get to heaven unless you personally believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and make Jesus Christ your Savior. Let's see, where am I going to now? Okay. One thing I wanted to say as well is, because Sodom and Gomorrah is made an example to us, you kind of think about the example that God actually sets with this town. Because when you think about Nineveh was a really wicked nation. But what did God do? God sent a preacher to them to get them to believe, you know, to, well, in those days, to turn from their sin and repent in those days. under the Old Testament, as they were preaching, to turn from your sins. But we know in the New Testament, turning from your sins is believing on the Lord Jesus Christ, not physically trying to stop sinning. So he actually sent a preacher and gave them an opportunity to be saved. But when it came to Sodom and Gomorrah, it fits the Romans 1 narrative, doesn't it? Where God, the reason why these people are so depraved and given over to those lusts, because God has given them over to a reprobate mind. These people cannot be saved anymore. And this is why he doesn't send the angels to go preach to them. All he's doing is sending the angels just to see and verify that the wickedness is actually taking place. No second chances. All he does is deliver the saved person out of that city and then judges them and overthrows them. And that's the example we set. That lines up with what we read in Romans 1. Did we read the rest of that? It came to pass when God destroyed... Yeah, that's it. That goes to Abraham. That God remembered Abraham and sent Lot out of the midst of the overthrow when he overthrew the cities in the which Lot dwelt. Now, before we finish, I know we've just got a couple of minutes left before 7. Let's just quickly go to Judges. I don't want to spend too much time at Judges because the story is very familiar. So it's very similar. So you can draw a lot of the same conclusions when we read this story in Judges 19. So hundreds of years later, we get to Judges 19. And we want to read from verse 22. And this story is, it's just as chilling. I mean, there are weird things about both of them. But, when you read through this story, it's quite bone-chilling as well. And it's interesting that the stories are so similar. When you read Genesis 19 and you read Judges 19, it's almost like it's the same event happening. And I wonder if what God is trying to teach us here is these people in Judges 19, the nation of Israel, did not learn from Genesis 19. And often that's the case, that if we don't learn from the mistakes in the past, often we're destined to repeat it. You know, this is often a famous quote, like those who don't learn from the past are destined to repeat it. And it's the same even in our personal lives, you know, when it comes to spiritual things. If we don't learn from mistakes we see in the past, mistakes that we see previous or even this generation do, and do something about it, we're just going to have the same problems with our children and our grandchildren. We have to make a change for things to actually change. Otherwise, we may just repeat history. Now, I'm not going to read the whole chapter, but, you know, this man from Bethlehem, Judah, he comes to his father-in-law's place, the father of his concubine, and, you know, he's spending a couple of days there just chilling out and just, eating and drinking and making merry. He then makes his way onto here, into Gibeah, and we see here the story of the sons of Belial in Gibeah. It says here, "Now as they were making their hearts merry, behold, the men of the city, certain sons of Belial, beset the house round about and beat at the door and spake to the master of the house, the old man, saying, bring forth the man that came into thine house, that we may know him." So you see how obviously the nation of Israel has not put these people to death, and the society has gotten to the same point where you have the same behavior of people just wanting to rape random individuals that come into the society and just want to violate them. "And the man, the master of the house, went out unto them and said unto them, nay, my brethren." It's almost like this is Lot. We're almost reading the story in Genesis 19. "Nay, my brethren, nay, I pray you, do not so wickedly, seeing that this man is come into mine house. Do not this folly. Behold, here is my daughter, a maiden, and his concubine. Them I will bring out now, and humble ye them, and do with them what seemeth good unto you. But unto this man do not so vile a thing. But the men would not hearken to him. So the man took his concubine, brought her forth unto them, and they knew her and abused her all the night until the morning. And when the day began to spring, they let her go. Then came the woman in the dawning of the day and fell down at the door of the man's house where her lord was till it was light. And her lord rose up in the morning and opened the doors of the house and went out to go his way. And behold, the woman, his concubine, was fallen down at the door of the house, and her hands were upon the threshold." So she's obviously like climbed onto the door. When he opens the door, she like falls over, right? Over the line of the door, the threshold. Look at this. Oh, when I read this verse, it's just, how cold. "And he said unto her, up, and let us be going. So he doesn't even help this lady up. I mean, you open a door and somebody just flops over in front of you dead. I mean, is the first thing you do just say, like, up, get up, let's go. You know, like, but none answered. Then the man took her up upon an ass, and the man arose up and gat him unto his place. And when he was come into his house, he took a knife and laid hold on his concubine and divided her together with her bones into 12 pieces and sent her into all the coasts of Israel. That is like just a weird, that's just so weird to do. I mean, I don't know if that's like something they did back then. I don't know. But, you know, when your concubine is dead on the threshold, I don't know whose first thought is, hey, you know what, I'm going to cut her up into 12 pieces and send her out to send a message to the rest of Israel. And it was so that all that saw it said, there was no such deed done nor seen from the day that the children of Israel came up out of the land of Egypt unto this day. Consider it, take advice, and speak your minds. So a really, really vivid story here, very similar to Genesis 19, where people have circled the house and they want to break this house down. And there's some lessons we can learn from this. I mean, one is, if you read the whole chapter yourself later, it seems as though the nation of Israel has become a very prosperous and complacent country, right? Because, you know, the guy is visiting his father-in-law, and you just read again and again, he's saying like, oh, you know, don't leave yet, just stay again. And they're just eating and drinking every day. It's almost like he's got no work to do. And is it because he has no work to do? Because it's just a prosperous nation. They're doing really well, and it's really prosperous, and they've been blessed by God. But often we see that, right? When we live in nations that are prosperous, we become complacent. Why? Because there's a lot of thorns in that nation. There's a lot of thorns in our day-to-day life that is choking us, making us unfruitful, keeping us busy and entertained, that we don't realize society is falling down all around us. Right? And this is why it's got to start with Christians being awake to what is happening in the world. You need to wake up. You need to make a difference and stop being taken away with the cares of this life. And then maybe we can save this nation from becoming another America, or becoming another Sodom and Gomorrah, or becoming like, say, New Zealand, where it's illegal to spank your kids, or in the UK when you can't preach against homosexuality. I don't even know if it's legal in Australia. I don't even care. But, you know, if we continue to do it, hey, then at least we make a stand. If somebody does get put in jail for preaching against homosexuality, at least there'll be an uproar. Whereas in Sodom and Gomorrah, that preacher that went and preached against homosexuality probably just got put in jail. Nobody knew about it. Nobody even cared. Why? Because they cared about the new car that was coming out, or the new laptop that was coming out, or all these, you know, these goodies that we have that keep us all entertained, that we don't really care about the things of God anymore. We don't even care about where our nation is going. We don't care about who's in office. We don't care about what's happening on the news or anything. Why? Because we're too prosperous. There's no tribulation. There's no persecution. Sometimes God has to send persecution our way. He has to send tribulation so that people will wake up. And it's almost like in this example, are we not going to learn? Does our society need to get this bad before we are willing to do something for God? You know, because it's not until this happens and then he cuts up his concubine and sends it out to the nation of Israel, then the nation of Israel comes in as one man and says, hey, bring those men out. We're going to do some judgment. Why did it have to get to that point? Why did the nation have to get to that point where people are so wicked to the point where they're going to want to gang rape somebody and rape this woman all night long? She needs to be cut up and sent out. Then they come and do something. This is why God wants them put to death now, because he doesn't want nations to get to this point. And we kind of think about in our lives, does Australia need to get to this point before you're going to go out and preach the gospel? Does Australia need to make preaching the gospel illegal before you wake up and cause an uproar? Are you going to use these freedoms while we have them? So if you read later, you can read Judges 20. You can read the reaction. Does it need to get to that point? And even here, so we see complacency, we see prosperity perhaps, but we also see a lack of care about the family. You know, you see how our society now doesn't really care about marriage, doesn't care about society. I mean, this guy, the woman he's with is not even his wife. The Bible makes it a point to say it's his concubine. And you can see when she falls over on the threshold, the coldness in that relationship. Where are their children? They don't have children. Maybe because they're so rich and prosperous. Man, having children, that's a burden. I can't go out and, you know, go on those holidays anymore. I can't get that career I want anymore because, man, children are going to hold me back. See, people, they are not caring about the things of God. They're too rich. They're too prosperous. They don't care about raising a godly generation next. They only care about themselves. Once they're gone, you know, who knows what's going to happen to the nation after they're gone if we don't do anything. It can only go downwards without righteous people in that nation. So we see the reaction. And the last thing, what I find always so interesting about Judges 19 is the way it ends. You know, like all this stuff happens, very similar to Genesis 19. He sends it out, the concubine, into parts, and it says here in verse 30, "And it was so that all that saw it said, there was no such deed done nor seen from the day that the children of Israel came up out of the land of Egypt unto this day." Look at this. "Consider of it. Take advice and speak your minds." So there is this vile story. I mean, he didn't say this at the end of Genesis 19. Why? Maybe because God allowed this to happen to show, hey, see, if you don't deal with homosexuality, adultery, and fornication in the society, it will repeat. So we have Genesis 19, then we have Judges 19, and at the end of Judges 19, he says, "Consider of it." So he's saying, yeah, you need to think about this. You need to think about these things. I know homosexuality is not a pleasant topic. I know we talk about fornication, it's not a pleasant topic, but you need to consider of it. You need to think, why is our society the way it is? It's because we allow these things. We need to think about what God is telling us here. Consider it. Think about it. Meditate on it. Why is God giving us these examples in the Bible? And then it says, take advice. Take advice is once you consider it, you think, ah, you realize now, yeah, this is why God put homosexuals to death and adulterers to death and people that sleep with animals to death, because he's given us these examples of what a society can turn into. And we need to take that advice. We need to trust God knows what's best. Believe it. Don't be that Christian that says, oh, you know, no, that's not really true. That's just an analogy. That's not really the word of God. You know, us Christians, we're just loving. We don't want to focus on the negative. We just want to be loving and just talk about Jesus. No, you need to take that advice, take it on board, and believe it. And what's the last one? Speak your minds. Don't stay quiet about it. Let people know what your opinion is. You know, I'm not scared to tell people what my opinion is about homosexuality at work. If they ask me about it, I'm going to tell them. You know, I remember having a conversation with a manager, and we were talking about, I can't remember, like vaccinations and stuff, and we're talking about that, and we got onto that topic, and then we were talking about Christianity and things like that. And I can't remember what it came down to, but it was like, she was talking about just these, I don't know whether it was like child rapists or something like that, and I was like, yeah, you know, they should be put to death, you know, according to the Bible. And then she was like, oh, but you're a Christian, like how can you be against the death penalty? You know, like, doesn't the Bible say thou shalt not kill? And you know what? It's because it's so many Christians not doing this, not considering it, not taking advice, not speaking their mind, that people have this idea that a God-fearing Bible believer thinks it's wrong to have the death penalty. No. Like, if they knew that all Christians just knew that, it's just, yeah, of course I believe in the death penalty. You know, I'm a Christian. I believe the Bible. I believe what God says is best, and you can explain it to them. You can consider it. Take advice so that when you tell them, they can also consider it. You know, you need to speak your minds. You need to speak up. And it's interesting here, you know, because it is about homosexuality. It is these men wanting to come and rape other men in both Genesis 19 and in Judges 19. God is saying here, consider of it, take advice, and speak your mind. So we need to speak our mind. We need to say, yes, it's disgusting. It's vile. It's sin. It's gross. It's wrong. Don't be scared to speak your mind. But also, hey, we got to think about how we need to be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. So obviously, when I talk here to you, I'm getting a bit riled up and talking about these things. I obviously don't do this at work. You know, I don't get up and just like, you're all wrong. You know, I explain things to them. And those of you who have gone soul winning with me, I'm more of that sort of personality when I'm trying to impart something to them. I want to be gentle because I want them to receive it. I don't want them to just think that I'm just, you know, closed-minded and whatnot. I want them to be able to discuss with me and give them some examples and say, well, this is why it is the way it is. So take advice. You know, when you wake up, don't stay silent. Let people know what you think and what the Word of God says. All right, I hope that was interesting for you. A different take, my take on Genesis 19 and Judges 19. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for your Word. Thank you for the examples you give us. Lord, help us to trust your Word. Help us to consider it and take the advice. And Lord, give us wisdom, Lord, so that as we consider and take this advice, it would give us boldness to be able to speak our minds, whether amongst family or amongst friends or amongst colleagues, or even in our churches, Lord. I pray that people would not be scared to discuss the Bible and speak their mind on the things that you've shown to them. And I pray, Lord, that as we grow in grace and in knowledge, that would give us boldness, that you'd fill us with your Spirit, so that when we do converse with our circles of influence, Lord, that we do it with confidence, and Lord, we can convince people with the faithful Word. So we thank you, Lord. Thank you for giving us your Word that we can study, and I pray, Lord, that we would continue to read and continue to meditate on these things. Give us wisdom, Lord. Give us boldness as we strive to swim against the tide in the nation we live in. We thank you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.